Gracious Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, you've been with us week after week as we come to the second last session of this Habits of a Disciple. Oh, Father, thank you. Thank you for being with us this evening as we study the word and meditate your word on this habit number three, which is the gift of tithing, the habit of tithing, oh Lord. Right now, I give myself and I give each one of us in this room, oh Father, you open our eyes that we may see wonderful things in your law. And we believe that you are in total control. Let your holy anointment fall on us. May you increase and may we decrease, oh Lord. Help us to make a transformational decision to practice this habit. Tell us the mysteries on this, oh Father. Teach us, oh Lord. As little Samuel said, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We just give our ears to you, our heart to you, so that we just not give 30-fold, 60-fold, but 100-fold. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Fantastic. Amen. Okay. So what's the habit number one did we study? What is the habit number one did we study?
Regarding the word of God.
Regarding the word of God. How to meditate, how to study, how to read or how to study the word of God. And what is habit number two?
Commit.
You're muted. Sorry, Michelle.
Commit.
Yeah, to pray.
Commit yourself.
Yeah, commit yourself for prayer. And how do you pray? So I taught you last time how to pray, right? So today we're getting into the third habit. So this is a very, very critical habit. I don't know how much you have known about this habit. How much do you practice this habit? I don't know not, but today I want to encourage you on this habit number three, which is a very, very critical habit for any believer or anyone who called to be a disciple of Jesus. Okay, so the next few minutes, I'm going to spend time about this truth. So this is how we are going to go. Okay, I'm going to give you a little bit of activity. What exactly we are going to do? What is this tithing all about, this habit? And I want to understand who are you? Okay, and then secondly, what it is to get and what it is to give. So does it really matters, or is there any difference between get and give? And what is tithing exactly? What does it mean? What does the Bible talks about it? And then I want to give you a few principles, or which I call the fundamentals, which we cannot compromise. And then why do you tithe? Do you really have to tithe? And there is a big famous excuse people give, because I've met some Christians who keep telling the same excuse year after year and do not practice this habit. The idea of having this habit part of this course, so that you take this as the arms and ammunition for practicing it. Got it? So how are you going to give? I'm going to give you a few tips and how you can be a great giver for the Lord. Okay, this is how we are going to go. If I were to come to Michelle and Richard and Paul and ask Wani one question. Can you give me the last 1 month calendar, your schedules? Like I take your calendar and your schedules, and then I ask you the last 1 month of your checkbook or your bank statement. What would you do?
If you want to ask it and see it, I would give it to you.
Thank you. So if I have to check, that would tell me how you have spent your time. All your schedules will tell you how Richard spends the time from morning till evening. Who has he met? Who has he spoken to? Who has he been with? If I have to ask you, that's on your time element. If I ever have to ask you your checkbook stubs and ask you how it has been, I get to know how your treasure, the so-called money bag, has been utilized, right? I just want to understand. So I like to start with this adage, which says, where your treasure is, where your heart is, right? I know not where your heart is, but your heart is where your treasure is. So what is your treasure? And where your heart is the number one question. So I want to understand, how has it been in your life and what is tithing to you? I would like to hear from each one of you around the table. Over to you.
Okay, well, for myself personally, this is going to be a bit hard, but at first, I did not believe in tithing because man ruined it for me. Because in the military, I've gone places and I've seen organizations and people and volunteers who gave freely to help rebuild, like NGOs, doctors of the free world, and of a devastation. Okay? Other countries, they donate money, they donate resources to the federal government of that country that needed it. And the victims of a tsunami, of an earthquake, didn't see the money. The politicians kept it in their pocket. And it's not just the government, police departments, other churches. When people have money, some they steal. So I thought, well, I'm not going to give my money or cannot go to the people. So I would give my money other ways. I'd go to the grocery store, and the cashier would ask, do you want to donate $5 to Salvation Army? Yes, I do. I would donate to War Acts. I would donate to the National Institution. I would donate that way.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Really appreciate that. And Michelle, do you have anything?
No, because I haven't really gone to church since I was a little kid. So as a kid, I never... My parents did that, where my sister and I didn't. So I do believe in it. I think in order to keep our churches running and to help other countries and whatnot, we do need to do it. Mm-hmm. I think it's an important part of it.
Thank you.
Our churches wouldn't be here without it.
Thank you for that reflection. Appreciate that. Brother Paul, you have anything to say on your practice?
Yes. For me, I had a privilege of learning about the fact of tithing, giving back to what God has given me. First thing I've learned in the scripture is that nothing belongs to me, it's everything God's. And what God has entrusted to me, I am responsible. So if you talk just about tithing, not only my finances, my time, my treasure, my talents, everything that belongs to God, but God is a gracious, the word tithing actually comes as 10%. So for me, very important is putting aside what belongs to God first.
Amen.
I want to start the day with the Lord first, so is my finances.
Lovely.
Whatever He has given me.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Thank you. So thank you for sharing your practice and your thoughts, and it's really nice. Yes, Richard, sorry.
Sorry, just one last sentence, because I want to finish. It's thanks to my wife that now I tithe properly, because when we got together, I tithe. So I said, well, I don't. But I give what I can. It may not be 10%, but it's what I could for that month that I had, and I would give it to the church as well as other organizations. But lately, because of my wife, now I actually tithe 10% all the time.
Lovely, lovely. Thank you. So let's get to hear what exactly the Bible talks about tithing. It's not about Chris talking about tithing, but I'm going to teach you what exactly this habit all about. and what significance it has on our lives and how does it matter right now. Okay, you remember this picture which I showed you sometime some weeks back. This is our session 4. And if you remember, if you want to be a part of being a disciple of Jesus Christ, there are certain habits you need to follow. And it is very critical that you demonstrate those habits. And one such habit is, of course, we said habit 1, habit 2. And the third habit, which we are talking about, is very critical, which is the habit of tithing. And I want you to read 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2. Which is a very interesting text. Brother Paul, you want to read 1 Corinthians 16:2? Or I can do it for you as well.
Okay, I have it here.
Okay, go on, Brother Paul.
First Corinthians 16, verse 2. On the first day of every week, each of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income, saving it up so that when I come, no collection will have to be made.
I just want to underline 2-3 words over there. One is on the first day of every week. So this is a question of, I want you to, if you have your highlighter or Bible or notes or wherever, I want you to write down this or even mark it off or code it and say it's not talking about on the last day, it is talking about first day. So it's like a first and foremost. It's not second or third or 15th or 14th. The first of everything. Say you get a paycheck. In Canada, we get paid bi-weekly, or if you're running your own organization, you get paid almost. Every week you get a consolidated paycheck. So you get a number around it. You get a total amount. So the first day of every week you're going to do. So it is not something I can, as I told you, it's not something I tithe for the family. It's tithe up for each one of you. Say, for example, each person has his own toothbrush. I cannot use someone else's toothbrush. So what do I mean by that? Each of them, if they are earning member, it's they have responsible. Each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income. Say 1 Corinthians 16:2 talks about it. So each earning member, somebody is not earning, that's a different question. But somebody is earning, it is important that we set aside an amount, which is what Paul is referring here. Where how you can honor God with your giving. Now, it's a sum of money you're going to do. It's the first part of it. And it should be proportionate to the income. Now, God is not telling us how much amount, but he's telling us how it should be proportionate to the income. Say somebody is making $50 only a week. We're just going to see what is the 10% of the $50, right? So likewise, we are going to see each one of us, every week, we come together, keeping that as based on the proportion of the income they make. I'm going to go into a little bit of detail to understand this particular habit so that it makes sense. Before that, I want to ask you this question. Who are you? Who are you? There are three kinds of people. If you feel free, you can give me the answer. But then who are you? The first set of person is like this, you know, he or she is a taker. You know, what's a taker? Hey, what can you do for me? 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 That's the only slogan. They only ask, what can you do for me? What can I get? What can I get? Right? So it's like when someone else get it, they have jealousy as well. And they're not comfortable with that. They are those people whom we call it as takers. Okay? Now there is a second set of people whom we call it matchers. You know what is matchers? You do this for me, I'll do this for you. It's like match. You do this, I do this. It's like a mirror effect. If you do this for me, will you do that for me? I do one favor for you, I'll do that favor for you. It's like they bargain with God. They say, Lord, if you do for me, I'll do this for you. You know, if you give me success in what I do, then I will come to church regularly. Then I will give you more money. Or some kind of negotiation. You get what I'm saying? No, those people are trying to strike a balance by giving and receiving, okay? Because they believe, perhaps they are not, I don't know predominantly who they are. Are they very liberal or they are people who are very diverse in their opinion? They want to be fair. They want to be equality. They want to say, okay, God, I give you 50 rupees. You have to give me 50 rupees back. Unless you give me 50 rupees back, I cannot. Or $50, I don't give you $50 back. Something like that. Now, then it's like we call the people of reciprocity style. You know, this, you give me this, I'll give you this. Something like that. Now, that's a mature person. Now, you find many times, right? You call somebody for birthday, they will call you back. Otherwise, they don't. Do they call you or not? I don't know. Some people, they want to match you. Because you do, they do for you. They apply to God as well. That's a sad piece. Now, the third kind of person is giver. Now, today, I don't know whether you are a taker or a matcher, but we are talking about, what can I do for you? Lord, what can I do for you? What can I give you? What can I give you? You remember the shepherd who came. And today we are heading on. In another few hours, we will be stepping into the advent of the Christmas coming in, right? And this is the perfect moment, the season for giving. And none of them who came and worshiped Jesus, they just want to say, what can I give? Even the drummer boy song we sing, what can I give you? What can I give you? So it's you're not giving because you get a benefit. You're not giving because I get something. You are giving. It's not because, I must. Oh, I should. But you're giving, I want. I like. I want to give. That kind of giving we are talking about. By the way, this is very contagious. Do you know that? It's very mm-hmm. contagious. When you start giving, everybody starts giving. It's you cannot resist it. It's so contagious. So that's the element of giving. That's what I can say to you. Okay. Now, I tell you, in your Christian walk, when you accept Christ, before accepting Christ, most of us are takers. Most of us are takers. What can I get? What can I get? What can I get? But after Jesus comes into your heart, you are no more a taker or a matcher. You become a giver. The world outside the church are matchers. You do one thing, they will do one thing for you. You don't do, they will not do. It's more like a mirror effect, reciprocity. But God is talking about giving. What can I do for you? What can I do for you? That's kind of giving he's talking about. Now, I told you about what the takers, their only slogan is what? Get. I get this. Lord, I get that. Give me that. You know, it's all about getting. 1 Timothy 6, 17, 18. Do you want to read 1 Timothy 6, 17, 18? Very interesting, that is. 1 Timothy chapter 6, 17, 18. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, not to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, to be generous and willing to share. Now, I want you to underline two words there. The word command comes two times. Two times. So giving is not something, it's not an optional. Command means it's a mandatory, it's an obligation. You cannot say, I have an option. Oh, I wish I can do. I wish. No, there's no wish over here. God says if the rich has more money, he's telling, don't become arrogant. You don't put your hope in the wealth because it's so uncertain. But with your wealth, you need to share. So he insists about giving. Now, if you read the latter part of the verse 19, in this way they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. I like this. We make a living by what we get, right? You earn money, you make your living. But when do you make your life? But what we make a life is by what you give. There is a whole difference between living and life. Agree, disagree?
Agree.
Yeah? You make money, you make a living. But you make a life by what we give. When do you have your fullness of life? Your true life is by giving. And many few people realize they stop with living. But today evening, I'm talking about not living. I'm talking about thriving and excelling and about life. Okay? So what about giving? Now, why are we talking so much about giving? I was just wondering, why are we talking so much about giving? Is it really, really matters?
Yeah, absolutely. It's what God does for us.
Yeah. And if you turn the pages of scripture from first to last page, you find the word giving, the word give, comes 2,162 times. That's a big number, really big number. Because when you compare the word love, it is only 714 times. So the intensity or the importance, God insists on the word give. God so loved the world that he gave. He loved that he gave his own and only son, that whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. So it's all about the combination. When you have love, love is just giving, not even half. It's only 714 times in the Bible, but 2,162 times in the Bible, you have the word give. Now, I found this very interesting. You can give. See, somebody can give anything without loving. They don't need love to do that. But you cannot love without giving. If you start loving someone, you want to give them something, right? If you have your partners or your children or anybody, if you love them, you will start giving them something or the other. You give them your time, you give them talent, you give them the presence, you give your presence. Whether the presence or presence, you give because you love. So you can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. So that's a big formula you need to keep in mind. Most of the time they say, okay, I love you, Jesus. Okay, you love you, Jesus, then automatically your love will convert to giving. Got it? Now we're getting into the habit 3, which is the habit of tithing. I don't know how many of you have a good muscle. How many of you could have a good muscle?
Richard.
Oh, lovely, Richard. Lovely. I see some arms. Now, how do you build your muscle?
By working and practicing every day.
Yeah. Now, I don't carry my weights at all. And I delegate every time, hey, you carry. Do you think I will have muscle? Now, your muscle, I tell you, faith is like muscle. Your faith is like muscle. Some of them don't even have only skin over there. No muscle, because they don't use their faith. Your faith grows up only if you use the muscle. So the more you use, the more you wrench it. And I'm Michelle, you're a carpenter, so you know it better, right?
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure Michelle's muscle will be super duper.
I'm strong.
Strong, lift anything, big tables and everything, because you use it. And likewise, faith is like a muscle. And you know why God uses faith as a muscle and why he is using your finance or your finances as a place? Because God wants to check your muscle of faith by testing it. If your faith has to be tested, God wants to touch your area of finance. So when you are broke, you don't have any money in your pocket, do you still trust God? Do you believe my God is the creator? He is the owner. He everything belongs. The earth is the Lord and everything in it. The earth is the Lord and everything in it. I don't have a dollar in my pack, in my pocket. My God is in control. I worship El Shaddai, the much more than enough God. So everyone who says, oh, my faith is super duper. The first test God, you know what he'll do? For example, Michelle, the first test is you won't get any business for 2 weeks. And then you say, God will see, okay, whether you're still trusting God. Whether you're still trusting God. Because God checked the finances. When you trust when you have money, or do you trust God when you don't, when you have a zero balance? So God used that. You know our friend Judas? God tried and tested him. Somehow his muscle did not grow. And he developed cancer. And he could not grow. And he did suicide. You know that, right? PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Yes.
Yeah.
Now, let's not forget that. So God tests the finances. And our brother Peter, God said, leave your nets. Oh my God, Jesus, my nets are so expensive. You're telling me to leave the nets? How can I leave my nets? No, leave your nets. And God tests you, right? So God tests the finances. God tests the resources. God tests the treasure. Where your treasure is, there your heart is. Let's not forget that, okay? This is a very interesting slide. I really like it, and I thought I should explain this to you. Because most of the time when people, what I would say is like, most of the time people don't understand this. Even many Christians don't understand this concept. So I think I need to explain this. What is tithing? Because many Christians today don't understand these three words. What is tithing? What is offering? What is excelling in giving? Okay, I'm going to explain to you today. Now, the very word tithe, the very word tithe, the origin of the word means 10th part. Not 10th part, it's like 10th piece. For example, I have a loaf of bread. I put a slice on my loaf of bread. The 10th slice will be the 10th part. Now you get it? That's the tithe. I have a loaf of bread. I make 10 slices. Slice 1, slice 2, slice 3. And my 10th part is called the tithe. Okay. Now that's simple as that. Now my first 10th. Now I have a loaf of bread. I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I reach 10. The first 10. That's the tithe. Not, I may put my slice, may keep coming, and there will be on the 20th, I still have a 10th piece. We're not talking about that piece. We're talking about the first 10th. Now, let me come in the value of money. Say I have the first value of money. You have the first paycheck or the first very good income you've got. The first 10th part is what you're talking about tithe. It's not that I use all the bills. For example, I got the entire amount. I pay for my utility. I pay for my energy. I pay for my rent. I pay for my everything. Then the leftover is 10th. No, 10th, first 10th part is count before doing anything. The first 10th part belongs to the Lord. And this God is very clear, because I tell you why. Because God is not counting what you gave him. God is counting what is left behind. Now, let me repeat it. God doesn't count how much money you gave him or how much amount you gave him. But God is looking how much money you have in your balance amount in your bank. In that secret place, how much money is left over? That's what he's checking. So now somebody gives less than 10%. Now somebody gives less than, it's okay. Sometimes believers, when they are still growing in this principle of giving, they don't know. If they happen to give less than 10%, say in your just walk with Christian life, you some days you're not making money, and then you're not giving tithe, or you're giving less than 10%, what is that called? It's not called tithing. You're actually taking away from God. You're robbing God. I will come to that. So why I'm saying that, I'll come to that. But tithing is something a mandatory, right? Mandatory is something like oxygen. Oxygen, if I don't breathe, I die. It's simple as that. If I don't tithe, I die. It's must. It's a must, must, must. Now, over and above tithing comes something called, which I call offering, means anything given in addition to tithe. For example, I give the 10th part, but over and above, I want to give it to the Lord's kingdom and I want to give it to the Lord. Chris, over and above tithing, you know how much difficult it is? No, that's what we're talking about. Macedonian believers did that. And lots are across the pages of Bible. The Abrahamic blessing is all about offering, right? And that is comes out of want. Now, many people, I don't know how many of them are really doing offering, but I have done in my life and I've seen 360 turn on that. It's super duper. You can never have regret on it because you make the Lord indebted to you and he has to pay back anyway because you give it to the Lord and it's over and above the tithe, okay? Now, there is another third segment, which I call excel in the grace of giving. Now turn to 2 Corinthians 8 and 7. 2 Corinthians 8 and 7. Now that's a very, very powerful verse which says, you know, for it says like 8 and 7, just as you excel in everything, you excel in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness and in your love for us, see that you also excel in the grace of giving. Excel in this grace of giving. So it's like a highest level of giving, which you don't have any number. You don't have a number or amount saying, okay, it's 10th part, over and above 10th part I give, but it's, you are excelling in giving. That's the highest level of giving. And you have seen many people are like that who have given everything and for the Lord and God has not stopped blessing them. And we are coming to that. So that's the three segment of tithe and offering, tithing, offering and excelling in giving. Any doubt till now? Any questions so far? Super. Going good. I like this. Look at my picture. I got this picture for you. Look at that. Have you seen this? If you're baking cakes, you will see this, right? I don't know how many of you are baking cakes, but how many of you are using these measures in your daily? Oh, lovely, Richard. Thank you. Now, I just thought these are principles. See, there are the law of gravity has a principle, right? We call it the law of gravity. Anything falls down, remains down. So, likewise, in the principle of tithing, there is a lot of things which we need to keep in mind. The first part versus last part. Now, tithing, I said, is the first 10th part. It's not the last 10th part. Many people think, okay, God doesn't bother about order. So you don't care. I spend as you like. And then later on, let me see if any money left over. Then I will go and do tithing. Our God is not a God is a not a God of confusion, but a God of order. He orders things. There's 1, 2, 3. So he is a God of order. So it's a first 10th part. The Bible talks, if you decide to tithe, the first 10th part, I get, receive the check, paycheck, and I just take the first 10th part and I give it. It's like you're take your meat, first piece, I give it. You get what I'm saying? I'm making it simple for you to understand.
Chris, do you know the word gross and net?
Yeah, gross and net.
Yeah, so 10% of the gross income and not 10% of net income.
Yeah. That's what you're saying?
Yeah, because gross.
Yeah, I know, but I'm happy you're looking at it from a gross income standpoint. But at least to encourage any believer at a starting point, if they start even tithing from a net income, because at the end you get your net deduction from your taxes, right? So if somebody, because they're paying the government anyway, what belongs to the government goes to the government. So what I'm trying to say is, even if you make a tithe from the net, it still makes sense. That's what I'm saying, but not less than that. Because you're making the deduction, what is made is not coming to us, it's going to the government, because what belongs to
Caesar, give to Caesar.
You're right. Good. So the second piece, what measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Now somebody will use the last measuring stick here. Look at the picture nicely. Why some people have money till the end? Why their cup is always overflowing? Because what cup you use is more important. I don't know which measuring stick you are using. Are you using the smallest, the teeny weeny, or the biggest one? You can see there are people, God doesn't care. Somebody gives $50, $100, somebody gives $5, $2. God doesn't care about the amount. But God sees how you're measuring based on the proportion of your income. Somebody has, say someone is a well-to-do, wealthy man, and if he's using a smaller stick, no, he's not measuring according to his income. So you can turn with me to Luke 6:38. That's a lovely, lovely verse, Luke 6:38. You want to read that? Luke 6:38.
I'm here. Let me know when you guys are ready and I'll read it.
Yeah, read, Richard.
Okay. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you.
So this is not my lines. I'm just putting the Bible words over there. The measure you use, it will be measured to you. Some people, they think, I tell you, it's not only applies to your tithe, to any aspect of life. How much you give, so much will be given to you. We call it the law of sowing and reaping. How much you sow, a farmer puts 5 seeds, 5 apple trees, you know how much outfold of apples he can get. But he puts 50 seeds, you know what's the growth of it, right? So it's like a seed. So how much you sow, so much you reap. Now the next formula is very interesting. Proverbs 11, 24, 25. You want to read that? 11, 24, 25. One man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous man will prosper. Not will. Not something like, oh, maybe. No, it is will prosper. Will. Will prosper. If you give, you will prosper. And he who refreshes others, he will himself be refreshed. If you refresh others, you will also be refreshed. Now, many people think, okay, I give it to the Lord, all my money is gone. What will happen to me? Will I be in dire straits, or will I be on the intersection begging bread? No, not at all. Generous man will prosper. It's like a promise, you can claim it. The Bible says that. And yes. Then God, yeah, go on.
Oh, I was going to say about, trusting the Lord and the Lord providing for you. Because it is written in the Bible that how God provides for the crows, and he loves us more than the birds, so he'll provide for us as well.
So that's very right. You're much more valuable than them. Much more valuable than them. That's what the word of God says. Now God set a proportion and not an amount. What do I mean by that? God set a proportion. He's not saying, say, for example, he told all the people in the earth, every week, week one, you have to give me $50. Week two, you have to give me $100. Week three, if he has put that as a number or a formula for everyone, it would have made life more difficult, right? Say, what will people who don't earn so much money, what will they do? But God is very smart. He did not put any amount. He put a proportion. That's what he's saying. You give according to your income. The tenth part according to your income. So many people confuse. So somebody coming to you and saying, hey, you should give this amount. That's not from the Bible. That's false teaching. The Bible tells you, you should give it according to your income, the tenth part. Or you give an offering, which is addition to the tithe. Or you give excel in giving, where you give your tithe, you give your offering, but you excel in giving. But then I would encourage you, the bare minimum is to start with the tithe, okay? So this is a principle which I want you to keep in mind. Now, having said this, why should you tithe? Why should I tithe? Number one, my friend, it's a command. There is no question of debating. There's no question of saying, oh, can I or should I or shall I? No, it's a command. Look, turn into Leviticus. It's a very nice book, Leviticus. And 27, 30, you want Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. That's where you find Leviticus. 27, 30. Verse 30. You want to read? Okay. 27:30, a tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. Now, I tell you, whenever you say it's a command. And when you give the 10th part, the Lord makes it holy. The Lord makes it holy. The Lord sanctifies it. So there's no question. There's no question of debating it. And whatever you do, I tell you, people practice not only giving tithe, they give their time, they give their treasure, they give everything. And that's where you find the Lord makes it holy. Leviticus 27:30. The second, Deuteronomy 14:23, it's like first reverence. You give a due respect to God. You keep the God like preeminence. You keep the God at the center. God becomes the first and foremost. After Leviticus, Numbers comes Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 14. Chapter 14, 23. You want to read that? It's a very nice verse.
Okay, I'll read it.
Go on, Paul.
14:23. Eat the tithe of your grain. Eat the tithe of the grain, new wine and oil, and the firstborn of your herds and flocks in the presence of the Lord at the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name, so that you may learn to rever the Lord your God always.
What are you going to do? Learn to rever the Lord. So whenever you're giving a tithe, whenever you're doing a tithe, you're revering the Lord, you're respecting the Lord, you're honoring the Lord. It's the best way to honor the Lord and say, Lord, you're the best, you're the first, and you're super, super of everything. And no compromise on it. Deuteronomy 16:17 tells one more thing. You want to read Deuteronomy 16:17? Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. So it's just being thankful. It's not once in a year doing a Thanksgiving. I keep saying that. It's not once in a day, once in a year you do a Thanksgiving gift or something. But God is saying, whenever you come to me, you're going to give that. Every week when you come, you're going to make a proportion of your income. And then you say a tenth part because you're grateful. Lord, you've done this for me. It's a gift. In proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. And I tell you, this verse changed my life. And perhaps it would change your life as well. Malachi 3, 8 and 10. Malachi 3, 8 and 10. Which is the last book in the Old Testament. You want to read that? 8 and 10. Very powerful. At least I can read one. At least.
Okay.
Go on, Brother Paul.
I got it.
Yeah, go on.
Verse 8 says, will a man rob God? Yet you rob me.
Will a man rob God?
Yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? In tithes and offering. You are under a curse, the whole nations of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that they may be food for my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it.
I tell you, this is the only verse where the Lord, in the entire Bible, the Lord says, test me in this. It's like, you know, he's challenging us. You test me. Test me in this. This is the only verse in the Bible it says, you know, you give your offering and your tithe, tithes and offering, and you see that if I don't bless you, you can test me in this. It's like a challenge. I dare say that. God is telling a challenge. It's a sure promise. That's what I'm saying. It's like an acid test. That's why I've written it as an acid test. Malachi 3:10, where he is saying, bring the whole tithe, not half the tithe, not little or less, or bring the whole, that there may be food in my house. When you just take care, bring your whole tithe, then you can see, test me. If I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing, you can test the Lord. I tell you, when you do that, you can easily see the hand of God. That's why I've written thief. If you don't give, you become a thief. That's why he said, why do you rob me? He says, why do you rob me? And when God blesses, you will not have enough room. You'll just think, oh my God, you're giving me so many things. I don't know where to keep these things. So many things for me. I tell you, you can try, test it. And God will pay you back like anything. I've done that and I've seen it happening. It's there is zero error rate. God can never make a mistake on this. If you're running out of something, take this coming week. Take that first piece. And you give it to the Lord and you see how the Lord will do it for you. There will not be any lack. The lions may go weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Not even one. I tell you, not even one. Every meal you will be thinking, oh God, you have fed me too much. I'm overflowing. I don't know. I'm throwing off my food. So much is I'm giving it to food bank. So much I have. You give it, you see the hand of God. Okay. Now, this is a very big excuse. I like this. Can you see this? I talk to my friends. They tell me, no, Chris, tithing. I don't know all this. That's all Old Testament. I'm a New Testament believer, you see. I believe in Jesus. So why should I follow Old Testament principles? That's what they tell you. Now, when somebody comes and tells you like that, beware. Don't get confused. Don't ever get confused with such people, because if you see, it is not an Old Testament alone. It's an Old Testament life principle. What do I mean? It's a life principle. It's not just a principle or only law pertaining to Old Testament, but it's just because you read more of it in Leviticus and Deuteronomy, people think, okay, this is a law given by Moses. My friend, this is not a law given by Moses or after Moses or after after they came out of Egypt into Israel, when they got settled into the Canaan land. That's when they think that's the commandment to follow. No, but the tithing principle came 400 years before Moses was born. God gave this principle called tithing. Do you know that? Turn with me to Genesis 14:20. Genesis 14:20. I know I'm making you to turn your Bibles left, right. It's like the muscle, like Michelle's muscle.
Genesis. I don't even know how you find these so quickly.
Years of practice.
Yeah, I can't.
It's okay. You do it slowly and then you'll become very thorough. Your Bible, as you can buy as many Bible, because only in earth we can use Bible. When you go to heaven, there's no Bible. So use as many Bible. Read. Genesis 14:20. You want to read?
I'm still looking for Genesis.
Okay, it's the first book in the Bible. You find Genesis chapter 14, verse 20 says, "Blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand." Then Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. Gold, I give you tenth. Silver, I give you tenth. I have a lot of clothes, I give a tenth. I have a lot of cash, I give you tenth. I give you a lot of gold coins, I give you tenth. So he gave everything tenth. Now, don't tell me this came after Moses. It came before that. So people who come and confuse you and say, "Oh, it's a very Old Testament law. It's not for New Testament." Sorry. It's a life principle God, the Creator, thought even before the Ten Commandments could come. Now, even when you come to New Testament, I'm not put the scripture verse here. Even in the New Testament, you see Jesus saying, you see the Pharisees, you give tithes, he says. In a way, he kind of commends them. He appreciates tithing and he appreciates offering. And that's why you find in Paul encouraging that as well. Okay, so this principle is very, very vital. So nobody can give some cock and bull reason for that. This is fundamental. People give a lot of excuses to escape the practice or the habit of tithing. Okay, so it's very, very age-old life principle. That's what I want to teach you. Any questions so far? Okay, thank you. So I'm going in. How should I do it? How should I tithe? To understand this, I just want you to read 2 Corinthians. Somebody wants to read 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 6 to 11.
I volunteer, Michelle.
I haven't even found my index section yet.
Lovely. So we'll give Michelle a chance now. Michelle,
well, you guys go ahead. I'm not even close to finding it. Corinthians 9.
You want to give a page number? Maybe it is New Testament.
9:16.
Should be around the...
No, I passed it.
Okay, fantastic.
No, I'm still not there. I'm blind in one eye, so it takes me a few minutes.
Okay.
Literally, I am. So.
No worries. Richard, do you want to read?
9:16.
Yes, hey. Found it.
9:6.
9:6.
6 and 7.
Okay, so 9:16.
9:6 to 11. Chapter 9.
Oh, sorry, 6 to 11. So, okay, is everybody ready?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm in the wrong page.
It reads, "Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work, as it is written. He has scattered abroad his gift to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way, so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God.
Man, thank you. Thank you, Richard. The number one principle I tell you, just keep this in, as I kept saying to you at the beginning, it's not the amount, it's the attitude. Before you start giving, just don't think, whenever you go to church or whenever you want to give to somebody, don't look at the amount, but what is your heart? Of course, amount is there, important, but I'm not saying your amount should be proportion to the income. But what I'm trying to say is check your attitude. How is your heart? How is your mind? How do you feel about it? Now, many times God tells you there is a certain decor or certain attitude you need to carry before you give. So how your attitude matters is more important than
your amount.
People think, okay, I give $100, I'm giving $1,000, and then they make a trumpet out of it. Oh, I've given. No. What is your attitude is more important. Now, the number one is give willingly, not reluctantly. I'm not saying it's written there. Look at that. Not reluctantly, put one big circle there. Not reluctantly. Oh, should I give? Should I not give? Oh, should I give? Should I not give? Oscillating. You're just not stable. You're just worried. Should I give? Oh, you're taking the money, then putting inside. Taking it, putting inside. You think God is crapped up? He doesn't know what you're doing? He knows, right? He knows everything. He knows the end from the beginning. He's an omniscient God. So give willingly, never oscillate. If you know your 10th part is, say, if for out of you earn a $50 in a month, or you're making a $500 a week, if you know what's a 10th percentage or 10th part, you're going to give it cheerfully or give it willingly. First, you have to will. Okay? The second thing you're going to do is joyfully. What is joyfully? God loves a cheerful giver, not a whiny, grouchy giver. I gave off here. What will happen to my income? I don't know. I have another 20 more days in this month. How will I survive? I don't know what will happen. Half the time you live in anxiety, panic attack, depression, sorrow. God will say, better you don't give, man. Your attitude is not good. Now, by the way, I want to tell you, attitudes are not first known to Jesus. Your attitudes are well known to Jesus. So you can't hide your attitude. Number two, attitudes are contagious. If you carry one attitude, you can give it like a corona or a COVID to your partner or to your family. Because everybody will have, okay, it's very difficult to give, you see. So this month I gave so much of amount. It's very difficult. And you're whining and complaining, and your wife also will believe that story, and she will also whine and complain. Because I told you it's a contagious. And your children also will become like you with that same attitude. God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver, no doubt on that. Now, third, give generously. No doubt. Look at that. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. You want, take the farmer, don't forget. If the farmer wants to eat off all the apples and not do any planting, I don't want to plant. I only want to eat today. Now what will happen tomorrow? No planting, no sowing, no generosity seen. So give generously. My humble way to start for you is decide. For example, you have an amount. I'm just giving a practical example for you. Now, what is 500? If I take somebody is earning $500 in a week, or you just, let's take it in a bi-week, because in Canada you get paid bi-weekly, right? If you say $500 you make, what is 10% of $500?
$50.
Okay. Now, if I have to break it for 2 weeks, how much?
200.
$50 if I have to break it for 2 weeks.
So 25 each week.
25 each week. Now you decide whether you want to give 25, whether all the 25 you want to give it to the church or you want to give it to missions. You want, of course, you have to give it to the church first because that's where your spiritual food is coming in from, number one. And then you can also tithe other people. Like you can give it to your missions, you can give it to Salvation Army, you give it to shelter homes, you give it to widows, you give it to fatherless, because you can choose, right? I don't know whether you saw the Christmas box, the box which we received and we packed a lot of stuff, right? So you can put $25. Now you bi-weekly, you got, I just gave a calculation. Now somebody wants to do more than tithing. Chris, I'm getting $50 bi-weekly, so 25, but then Lord spoke to me, I'm going to give extra $10. Now, that is not tithing, that is like offering. You get what I'm saying? Over and above. But somebody says, no, I want to give $100. Let me, God said, test me in this. Let me see whether he does it for me. I tell you, because he said, test me in this, outpouring floodgates of heaven will pour out, certainly. And God sees what's in your hand. You remember the lady with two coins who came?
Yep.
And she was she took the center stage than anybody who gave that day, right? She took the center stage. So give generously. Now I want you to read 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 3. Somebody wants to read?
2 Corinthians 8 verse 3.
Hmm.
For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own.
Even beyond on their ability. Someone says, no, I can give only with my ability. No, you can also, that is the third level of giving, excellent grace of giving, which is beyond your ability you want to give. And that's what the Macedonian believers did. So give expectantly. You know, you expect. I will expect. My God is the principle of sowing. Now, let me ask you one simple question. This is the biggest analogy you can think when you want to give beyond your ability. Can you count? Simple question. Can you count? You may have a count on your number of apples in your hand. You may count how many apples. Say you have 50 apples in your hand. But can you count the number of seeds in an apple once the apple is sown, once you plant? So that's the power I'm talking about. You may plant only 5 out of it or 10 out of it. You have 50 apples. Say somebody choose to do 30 apples out of it. Do you know how many seeds it can have and how many apples it can give? That's the power of God. The God is in control of it. So give expectantly. Don't, by the measure you use, you will be measured. Give it beyond their ability. And the Macedonian believers did not lose anything. And that's why the Lord says, test me in this. Test me in this. That's what he says. Any questions so far? I want to encourage you before we come to the final leg of today. I just want to encourage you today is this. If you have not given so far and you're listening for the first time about this habit, don't worry. Don't worry about it. What is gone is over. But let's make a decision today. Lord, I want to start with what I have right now. I want to start with the bare minimum of tithing. And I've decided to do tithing. Now, you know, God chose the money aspect more important because God knew if somebody has to stay in this planet Earth, we spend half our life or the entire 80, 90 years of our life only working, working, working. And God knows that the only way he can work through our faith is by touching our finances. So make a decision. Let's make a decision today. I want you to repeat what I'm going to pray right now, and may the Lord excel, okay? Gracious Heavenly Father.
Gracious Heavenly Father.
Lord, here now.
Lord, here now.
Here now.
I make a decision, O Lord.
I make a decision,
O Lord.
I'm not happy with my giving.
I am not happy with my giving.
I decide today.
I decide today.
I decide today.
I commit myself.
Meeting myself.
I commit myself.
I cannot do it my own way.
Not do it my own way.
I want to obey your command.
I want to
follow this habit of tithing. I submit myself, Lord. And may you increase through this.
May you increase through this.
Thank you, Lord, for listening.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' name, we ask.
In Jesus' name,
we ask. Amen. 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 I tell you, the Lord says, test me on this. So that's a big form, sure formula and a sure promise. No doubt on it. So go ahead, try this habit and let me know the success when we meet up next time. Okay? Any questions so far? Yes, Richard?
I can share a success, like you said.